there's another speech in the Jeffrey Hall. This one was going to be on a topic which has caused some discussion in other meetings during the week. Lenin, the politics of internationalism, and I'll introduce you straight away to Duncan Harris.
Well, don't applaud, you haven't heard it yet. Comrades, I want for a few moments to try to recreate something of a world that is beyond the recollection of any of us here. The world of international socialism in the years before the First World War. On Sunday, the 22nd of November, 1912, in Bath, there was assembled an extraordinary congress, a special congress of the Second International, called specifically to deal with the obvious and impending threat of European and world war. At that congress, a declaration was adopted. I am going to quote to you only its concluding sentences. They went. Calling on workers, demonstrate everywhere and by every means against the threat of war. Let the capitalist world of exploitation and mass murder be confronted by the proletarian world of international working class solidarity. That, having been unanimously adopted, nearly 600 delegates from 23 European countries, many of them representing massive organizations, the concluding part was read out in three languages. In French, by Jean Jaurès, the outstanding leader of the French Socialist Party and also the leader of its right wing, not its left, its right wing, in German, by Victor Adler, the original founder and grand old man of Austrian socialism, and by James Keir Hardie, leader of the British Labour Party on behalf of the British Labour movement. Actually, when you think about it, it's a rather remarkable thing. It would be difficult to imagine the leader of the British Labour Party in Parliament today talking about the capitalist world of exploitation and mass murder, would it not? It appears, therefore, you see, and this was the appearance, as a growing internationalist working class movement fundamentally opposed to the existing order, the existing states, to imperialism, to the nationalism of the great powers. A movement based on class struggle and internationalism. That was the appearance, and millions believed it. One of those millions was Vladimir Lenin. Because, of course, it was not simply a question of taking the part of the Congress. In the decade previously, the whole threat of imperialist war had been a central preoccupation for socialists. In particular, 1907, Stuttgart Conference, repeated again in 1912, had adopted a resolution. Adopted it at the end of the day nearly unanimously. Binding on all the constituent parties. That resolution was drafted by August Bebel, who was then a very old man for the German, the SPD, the German Social Democratic Party, by Rosa Luxemburg, representing the minority in the German party, the left minority, by Lenin, representing the Russian party and various others. That resolution, it is necessary actually to read the operative part. It's a very long resolution. It is full of analysis. The nature of war, the causes of war, the nature of imperialism, militarism, etc., etc. What is significant for us here is the conclusion, which the Basel Congress was called to reinforce. And that conclusion was as follows. If war threatens to break out, It is the duty of the working class, under its parliamentary representatives in the countries involved, remember these are mass parties, in varying degrees, but with substantial forces, supported by the coordinating activity of the International Socialist Bureau, the leadership of the International, to exert every effort to prevent the outbreak of war by all the means that are most effective, which naturally vary according to the accentuation of the class struggle and the general political situation. If war nevertheless breaks out, it is their duty to intervene in favour of its speedy end and to do all in their power to utilise the economic and political crisis caused by the war to rouse the peoples and thereby hasten the abolition of capitalist class rule. They all voted for it, and the Basel proposition reinforced it. Now, Lenin, as I say, had a hand, a substantial hand, in drafting that resolution, thought it was a marvellous resolution. Immediately afterwards, he wrote, the position adopted is rich in thought and precisely formulates the task of the working class, the most resolute and revolutionary action by the workers' parties internationally. It was an illusion, comrades. It was an illusion. But it is necessary to start from that illusion in order to understand that the events of August 1914 represented a fundamental break in the division, in the working class movement, more fundamental than anything before or since, more even than the arguments about the Russian Revolution, which I will come to later. That fundamentally, you know, the notion that in reality there was a big internationalist movement, and that it was possible for this movement, this powerful movement, actually, in the relatively short term, to transform the situation and so on, was an illusion. August 1914 was a shattering experience for serious internationalists. A shattering experience. What actually happened, as comrades know, I'm sure, is that the leaders of the major socialist parties in the warring countries came to support not the most resolute struggle against imperialist war, etc., etc. They came to support, and indeed in the majority of cases, they actually joined governments pursuing imperialist war, and they savagely persecuted those of their followers when they had the power, who maintained what had been the line of the International. German Social Democratic Party, I mean its parliamentary representatives, voted for war credits, voted therefore politically in effect to support the war. When this appeared in their central organ, their Berlin newspaper, Lenin, who by this time was in Galicia, part of the Austrian Empire, Polish ethnically, when he got a copy, his declaration was immediately, his reaction was, it is a forgery. It is a forgery by the German General Staff to spread confusion. He could not bring himself initially to believe that they would betray everything that not just he, but they had said they stood for. And similarly with the French, the British, and so on. Here's James Keir Hardie, who was on the left, by the way, in the arguments about the anti-war struggle. He kept going on arguing, we must call an immediate general strike on the outbreak of war, a position which Lenin described as ultra-left, impossible, and so on, for various reasons. Actually, the British Labour Party supported the war, and within 2 years, were represented in the war cabinet. This enormous, shattering turnaround, the illusion that there was an international movement, a real international movement in the meaningful sense, was destroyed. And it is from that position But Lenin came to develop a fundamental criticism of all that had gone before, which he had supported, and therefore an entirely different view about what had to be done in the future. First, you've seen the reality. What was Lenin's position? When he realised, actually, it is not a forgery, unfortunately. It is not a forgery. That really is the situation. His position was immediate. Immediate. It is necessary to split from the social traitors, as he called them. It is necessary to split. The movement that we thought was actually a Marxist and revolutionary movement is led by opportunists, is led by traitors. It is necessary to split. It is necessary to build again from the beginning. Quite a... not simply radical, but some people would have said, impossibilist position, because we should not have illusions, comrades. The great majority of the supporters of the social democratic parties in the various countries actually, for all sorts of reasons, actually supported their position of their leaders. When we talk about the split, we're talking about a tiny minority. That is the first thing. We must split. Second thing is, we must characterise the war. We must tell it as it is. We must tell the truth. The leaders of the German party say the reason we support the war is if the Allies win, Russia wins, Tsarism, barbarism, the destruction of all the gains the German working class have made over the previous decades. Leaders of the British Labour Party said we must support the war because of the rape of Belgium, German imperialism, the Kaiser, the victory of the Kaiser represents a shift back for decades, European reaction and so on and so forth. And the French could say it with more conviction, because at least they got as far as having a republic, which the British haven't yet, you know, democratic republic. Each and every national group produced a series of special arguments as to why it was necessary, critically or otherwise, to support, in quotes, their own governments. And that position had a logic of its own, of course, from supporting the position. As I said earlier, that meant actually attempting to dragoon the working population in support of the war, to support repression against critics from the left, and so on and so forth. Now, the internationalists as a whole, it turned out, well, where we were the overwhelming majority, it was unanimous, there are a handful. Two things, therefore. First of all, characterise the war. I don't want to inflict long quotations on comrades, but this one is central. This was Lenin's first analysis, first political statement, as opposed to the fact that they are traitors. You know, this is the basis of internationalism today, i.e. in 1914. First, the war is an imperialist war. The war is being waged by the different ruling classes to struggle for control of various parts of the world to redivide the colonial empires. Colonial policies have brought about the almost complete partition of the globe. The essence of this war is a struggle between ruling classes for a repartition. It is totally reactionary. And then he goes on to say, world capitalism's productive forces have outgrown the limited boundaries of national and state divisions, and the objective conditions, therefore, are ripe for socialism to be achieved internationally. The imperialist war is ushering in the era of social revolution. All the objective conditions of recent times have put the proletarian revolutionary mass struggle on the order of the day. It is the duty of socialists, whilst making use of every means of the working class's legal struggle, he was not alone to that, you see, whatever legal opportunities there are, to subordinate each and every one of these means to the immediate and most important task, to subordinate them. Develop the workers' revolutionary consciousness. Rally them in the international revolutionary struggle. Promote and encourage any revolutionary action, and do everything possible to turn the imperialist war between states into a civil war for the of the oppressed classes against their oppressors. A war for the expropriation of the capitalist class for the conquest of political power by the proletariat and the realization of socialism. In all the advanced countries, the war has placed on the order of the day the slogan of socialist revolution, the conversion of the present imperialist war into a civil war is the only correct policy. Now, that position was received by hardly anyone. In fact, you could say it sounded like a stone. But by 1915, there was the beginnings of a development of opposition in the major imperialist countries. And this opposition is very important to us. We need to look at its political character. It had three components. First of all, let's look at its actual organisational form. The Italian government, Italian imperialism, for a whole number of reasons, had not yet committed itself to one side or the other in 1915. It was to do so the next year. It made a calculation where it's into slavery. And therefore it was possible for the leaders of the Italian Socialist Party to go on repeating the slogans of Stuttgart and Basel and so on, because they weren't put to the test yet, were they, you see? And of course, it was also possible for the Socialist Party, dear, neutral, cuckoo clock land Switzerland, also to take, because they're not put to the test, they don't have to fight the Swiss bourgeoisie, to maintain a formally internationalist position. These two parties, both significant affiliates of the International, called a congress. It was held at Zimmerwald in Switzerland, a tiny ski resort. And their appeal, the appeal by two big, well, one big and one significant party, met a very, very small response. There is this lovely quotation, it's from Trotsky actually, but I can't resist it, if I can find it. And if I can't, I'll paraphrase it. I think I can find it. Well, what's on that page, I can't. Yes. The delegates. There wasn't a railway line to Zimmerwald, it wasn't important enough. So they then, the delegates, filled four stagecoaches, still with horses, set off for the mountains. I told you it was a ski resort. The passers-by looked on curiously at the strange procession. The delegates themselves joked about the fact that half a century after the founding of the First International, it was still possible to seat all the internationalists in four stagecoaches. Because of the notion of the relationship of forces. There were, in fact, approximately 40 of them. But, and this is important, very, very important, in understanding how Lenin's ideas developed. Amongst this group of people who were willing to attend an international conference, often illegally. After all, the war is on, it's treason to talk to Germans, if you're French or Belgian, actually the Belgians weren't there, and vice versa and so on, and the British, of course, they couldn't get out at all because the British government takes advantage of the fact that you're an island here and you can't get out without a passport, there was no British representation. These 40 actually represented the extreme left wing of European social democracy. However, in their great majority, they were not prepared to accept what were for Lenin the two fundamental considerations. The first was the break, the split with social democracy, with the traitors. The recognition that August 1914 represents a fundamental divide in the road, that those who have gone one way are lost. They are part of the class enemy. It is necessary to start again and so on. On the contrary, they were concerned to do two things. First of all, the argument, peace by negotiation. You know, we must bring pressure to bear, of course, you know, very familiar arguments. But at the end of the day, the imperialists, red in tooth and claw and all the rest of it, must be persuaded to accept a peace without annexations, without indemnities, etc., etc. They must be persuaded, not overthrown. Secondly, the means whereby this is to be done is the recreation of the international, the broad international, which collapsed in 1914. Bolsheviks found themselves in a minority. Very small minority, actually. Truth is, the delegations of the Zimmerwald left, there were eight of them, to be precise. Two Bolsheviks, who represented something real, in Russia at least, and six other people, who represented precious little. Anywhere, right? The majority who did represent something, they represented what I would call the centrist anti-war position, were quite willing to subscribe to a general denunciation of imperialism and war, and did. It was written by Trotsky. Even Trotsky at that time would not accept the line of the thing I read out, imperialist war, turn the imperialist war into a civil war, and so on. Actually, they produced a statement which we would describe today as a typical soggy statement. They deplored the horrors of war, etc. They called for negotiations between the powers. They called for peace. The world demands peace, etc., etc., etc. That, remember, was the extreme left. The extreme left of the movement in Europe. You think we're isolated? My God. You know, the isolation of Lenin and Zinoviev, who was his representative at the conference at the time, was vastly, vastly greater. They had six supporters, not one of whom represented an organisation that was more than a Tukmihatli organisation. All the real forces, either with the chauvinist right, the great majority, or with the pacifistic, soggy, confused CND type left. All right, we'll say something about this. Nevertheless, even that soggy, confused left was very important. Important fact. You know, Zinoviev, Lenin was not a delegate. With the full support of Lenin, nevertheless voted for the soggy resolution. Lenin wrote afterwards in defense of this, in the given circumstances, any declaration against the war by significant social democratic forces represents a step forward. It would be, he said, sectarianism for us to refuse to take this step. But at the same time, they insisted on publishing their own defeated by all the votes to eight, resolution which contains the central things: break decisively with the Second International, break decisively with the social traitors. We know now they are not on our side. The British Labour Party is actually a bourgeois, an instrument of bourgeois class rule, although its working class, its base is working class. The SPD in Germany is exactly the same. Break with them, first. Secondly, not peace by negotiations between the imperialist bandits, Lenin's expression, not mine, he went into these picturesque things, but rather revolutionary struggle everywhere, wherever possible, and by whatever means possible. Important to make the point, Lenin, as I say, was not an ultra left. That did not mean that he thought those people in Germany who sympathised with him ought actually to somehow or other get hold of a pistol or something, or a bomb, and go out and shoot the first soldier they could see, or blow up a police station. No, no, no. It's a question of a mass movement. Politically, must break and organise. There was a subsequent conference at Kintar, which I will not go into, at which essentially the same thing was repeated. But in Kintar in 1916, it was in some ways different. Why was it different? Because the impact of the war upon millions and tens of millions was by this time being different. There was mass enthusiasm for the war in 1914, you know, amongst working people. There was mass enthusiasm. Read the accounts. 1916, you think about it, a series of events. Verdun, the Somme, the Brusilov offensive, the massive slaughter, the incredible slaughter. I don't know how many comrades saw this. July the 1st, 1917, was the beginning of the Somme offensive by the British with some French support. In the course of that battle, the British Army, by its own figures, suffered 430,000 casualties. Can you imagine the magnitude? 430,000 in a few weeks. The French, by their figures, 180,000. The German defenders, by their figures, 395,000. And all in an area less than 40 miles long and 3 miles wide. The immense slaughter. Verdun, the slaughter was even greater. Brusilov offensive in Galicia, even worse, broke the back of the Russian army. The enormous casualty rates, first. Secondly, the increasing economic difficulties, increasing economic stringencies, radicalization on a simple anti-war basis, the demand for peace. Now, the demand for peace, of course, has to be articulated by someone, and it was the very sort of people who at Zimmerfeld and Kintal had argued, you know, negotiations and so on. They were there. They were typically deputies, members of parliament, etc., etc. They were a focus. And so this group of, we shall call them soggies, actually representing very little in 1915 and standing out there, had some moral courage. 1916, began to feel the groundswell of support. And of course, there were a number of important events. There was, above all, the Dublin Rising. The Dublin Rising, which the vast majority, eastward, the vast majority of social democrats, left as well as right, condemned as an adventure. For Lenin, it was marvellous. It was the first stroke of lightning through the dark skies. And to those people who said, come on, these are Irish nationalists. Many of them are papists, religious, superstitious, and petty bourgeois, and so on. Said, look, those who expect to see a pure revolution will never live to see it. This heroic struggle must be, you know, distinguishes between those who are serious, serious when we talk about turning the imperialist war into a civil war, and those who merely talk. There was also a substantial rising in Russian Central Asia, rising of Turkish speaking peoples and so on. The situation on the world scale was changing. Actually, of course, it was changing more than even Lenin and Co. recognized, because February 1917, very much later, less than a year after the Dublin Rising, the Russian army broke, effectively, disintegrated, the February Revolution occurred. Now, the impact of the February Revolution on Europe was enormous. Was enormous. The situation both in Germany and in Britain, less so than in France, but still, well, important exception, in Germany and Britain, there were large-scale demonstrations. There were strikes which had on a big scale, which had a formally economic content, but which, as Lenin said, they are really strikes for peace. All, of course, illegal. all against the established leadership, the trade union leaderships, Labour, Social Democrats and so on, scandalous, you're helping the Germans, you're helping the British, go back to work, German agents, British gold, all this stuff, yes. Actually, it is the break, it is the beginnings of the real break. And of course, the impact of the October Revolution a few months later was enormously greater. The turn the imperialist war into a civil war slogan, which in 1914-1915 had seemed utterly unrealistic, Trotsky said that actually, utterly unrealistic, now began to take on certain elements of reality. And it is in this connection that we must discuss the problem of what Lenin called the centrists. Now then, look here. When in 1915 there's only a handful of us willing to stand out against the war on any basis, even a Christian pacifist basis, actually you don't quarrel too hard with your allies. You say actually you're wrong, you're soggies, you're blah, but still we vote for your revolution, it's a step forward. But under the conditions of 1917-1918, situation is transformed. There is a real revolt, a real mass revolt. And a certain, not simply the strike race, political indications of this. If we take the most important case, Germany, in the spring of 1917, German Social Democratic Party split. Actually, what that meant was that the right moved in and expelled the pacifistic, confused and so on left. And they formed the Independent Party. That party began to grow enormously and very, very rapidly. You see, because of the extreme tensions in German society, of the growth of hatred of the war, the casualty lists, the food shortages, and so on and so forth, grew very, very rapidly. And continued to grow, of course, for the next 2-3 years. In France, where there were very large-scale mutinies in the French army in the summer of 1917, a similar phenomenon. The French Socialist Party, which had supported the war, waving the tricolour, you know, you can always do this left-wing support for reactionary causes, Robespierre, the Convention, the 14 armies of the Republic, I don't know whether you know the rhetoric, but you know, the appeal to 1793 in support of a cause which was actually nearly diametrically opposite, but nevertheless had been very effective. Actually, in the course of 1917, the right wing lost control, and they were replaced, not by Bolsheviks, but by the confused, the left, the thoggies. And there is a general lesson here too, comrades, is there not? Because this is what happened in Russia itself. Come on. Early 1914, insofar as there were political organisations with real support, the Bolsheviks dominated the Russian working class. After February 1917, because it dominated a layer of class-conscious, fairly politically conscious workers. Yes? After February, what happened? Why? An enormous mushrooming of support for the SRs, who had the Socialist Revolution, had the great advantage of not standing for anything definite, and therefore being able to appeal to all kinds of people, exactly as in Portugal, you know? Flowers at the end of the rifles, the soggies, grow, 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 which is marvellous. Actually, it's marvellous and progressive, provided we understand clearly that that represents a radicalisation and that it is necessary to distinguish very, very clearly between the progressive aspirations of their newly risen supporters, newly risen to consciousness supporters, who actually have revolutionary aspirations in the sense that they want a new world, and their leaderships. The problem, therefore, was to fight now against the centrists, and at the same time, after the October Revolution, centrally important, the question of carrying the revolution in Europe forward. I'll digress for a moment. Comrades will know, or maybe not, but at any rate, in April 1917, Lenin abandoned position, the political position he had held since 1903, and particularly since 1905, about the nature of the Russian Revolution. I always spend time on it. It's He wants to dispute it, don't worry, we'll deal with that afterwards. I said it as a fact, and accepted the perspective and persuaded his party, which was very reluctant, to accept the perspective that the immediate object is workers' power. Again, I repeat, not an ultra-left, not in the sense that, you know, we're a minority at the minute, that we can simply achieve it by saying so, but that is the strategic aim towards which we are supporting. We do not give critical support to the revolutionary, so-called revolutionary government of, it became Kerensky in the end. Actually, we seek to overthrow it and replace it by power of workers organized in Soviets, workers' councils, and so on. An essential part of that perspective was, of course, the revolution in the rest of Europe. Rest of Europe. A revolution in a number of advanced countries in Europe. An essential part of that perspective. Because, of course, Lenin had argued previously, and he had not changed his mind about this, the objective conditions for workers' power and the achievement of socialism in Russia as such do not exist. That had been his position. He didn't change it. What he changed his perspective, because he saw the rising tide of struggle in Europe. Now, the most important thing for us to understand is he was not mistaken. He was not mistaken about that. I quote from a man who became a reactionary and a neo-fascist, but who, under the conditions of great radicalization at the time, is a German-speaking, Hungarian, you know, middle class and what have you, was swept along for a moment, not for a moment, for several years into the communist movement. He's a reactionary, a fellow called Borkenau. Doesn't matter. Here he is telling what he actually saw, because he was there. That day, and he does it very, very specifically. January 1918, a mass wave of strikes swept not only Austria-Hungary, but also the German Empire. There were all sorts of demands. More rations, centrally, more money, but everywhere, peace, 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 which in the circumstances is a highly political slogan. He says, I can't resist quoting to you. In January 1918, mass strikes developed in Austria-Hungary and Germany. It started the factory of Manfred Weiss near Budapest, by far the biggest munitions factory in Hungary. The strike spread like wildfire. By the 16th, of January, it had reached the munitions factories of Lower Austria. On the 17th, all Vienna went on strike. In a few days later, the Berlin munitions workers followed suit, and then the engineers, and many other branches of industry all over the Reich. Nowhere had the official leadership called the strike. The movement shook the central powers to their very foundations. That's the reality, comrades. It was there, the mass spontaneous, he said absolutely rightly, not only the official union leaders not called it, the Soggies, you know, the growing Soggy anti-war socialists had not called it. Adventure, that sort of thing, you know, you get your head chopped off. No, there was this tremendous dynamic, this tremendous potential. It was on that perspective that Lenin was banking. But, hear very well, spontaneity, spontaneous struggles will occur. The working class will, under certain circumstances, fight, given the worst kind of leadership. But for the fight to be successful, it is indispensable to develop, amongst the working class, a layer, a cadre of people who understand the nature of struggles, the traditions of Marxism, and so on and so forth, the party. And for Lenin, of course, the party was the International Party. Hence we come to the problem, the last point I will make, the problem of the Communist International. You see, I said, in 1915, Lenin was politically isolated. I don't want to go into this, but you can look it up in first book, the truth is, he didn't even at that time had the majority of the Bolsheviks with him. He didn't at that time. He's politically very isolated. 1918, 1919, situation's totally transformed. Now, none of us have had the good fortune to have gone through such an experience and seen such enormous transformation. Some of us have seen lesser ones. you know, we get a bit long in the tooth, but I mean, Portugal is a good example on the case. But, you know, this enormous change rate. In 1914-15, to be on the revolutionary internationalist left was to be an outcast. In 1918-1919, not to be on the revolutionary left, in words at any rate, was to isolate yourself from masses of leftward moving workers. Hence the whole problem. Communist International, leadership is necessary, tradition is necessary, the whole operation is an attempt to graft, no, not to graft, I don't like that phrase, to fuse the Bolshevik experience with the massive radicalization, real massive radicalization of millions, not millions, hundreds of thousands of workers, and through them millions in the European countries, and thus to push through to completion the European Revolution, or at very least the German Central European Revolution. Okay? That's the central thing. Hence, the whole problem of what Lenin called centrism. Simple fact. The German Independent Party started in, I think it was February, March 1917. People expelled, so on and so forth. By the summer of 1918, it was significant. It had tens of thousands of supporters. By the summer of 1919, it was claiming to have 800,000 members, which is certainly bullshit, you know, statistics of this sort, but it nevertheless is a reflection of the, you know, enormous... problem is, it's led by people, incorrigible centrists. The point is to win that mass and at the same time to split, to break with the centrist leaders. So the internationalism in practice at that time meant, not now, going over 1914 and the right-wing arch traitors and so on. Yes, yes, we know that. No, the situation had changed. The situation had changed. The problem for Lenin then, and for those who thought like him, was how do you create, in a short time and with great difficulties, a situation in which this radicalized mass is there. We didn't create it. Circumstances created it. How do you create, how do you create a situation where there are real, effective, experienced communist leadership? We know that the operation ultimately failed. Ultimately failed. It is a fact. It was touch and go. It was touch and go. Well, I haven't time to go into it. I want to argue, though, three things, which I'll conclude. First, the attempt was absolutely right. It was absolutely right because August 1914 does represent a fundamental divide. The right wing split the movement in 1914. They split it on national lines. That's the real, the fundamental split. The various centrists and soggies who don't, you know, say, oh, nasty Bolsheviks splitting this, that and the other afterwards, actually, the first and fundamental split occurred in 1914. From that time onwards, not talking about tactical relations to their members, but as entities, we can say, as Lenin said, the social democratic parties are actually, in spite of their class composition, in the essence of their politics, agencies of the bourgeoisie within the workers' movement. They are part of the class enemy. We have to deal with them differently than other sections of the class anyway, because of their working class base. We have to relate to it in various ways. The whole argument about the United Front tactic against ultra-leftism and so on. But strategically, that breaks the fundamental one. Secondly, it was right because the possibilities were real. You know, we failed at the end, yeah? And the results of that failure were very, very disastrous for the movement internationally. But you know, you think, actually long before Lenin, you don't really have to be a Marxist because Marx hasn't been born either. You have to recognise that there are certain times at which real transformations are possible. You know, the thing in Shakespeare, there's a tide in the affairs of men, which taken at the flood leads on to fortune. Once omitted, all the balance of their lives is spent in shallows and in miseries. Now, there was a tide, there was a real tide, there was the attempt to seize that tide, and it was nearly successful. And all those centrists and so-called anarchists and so on, whingers, who want to criticise the attempt to seize the tide, actually show that in reality, when there is another tide, they'll be on the other side, and they'll more likely be stranded on the beach. You know? Because, come on, you look at the reality of the thing. The third and final thing is this. You see, Lenin argued in substance as follows. And I will put it in simpler words. My English is simpler than his Russian translated into English. It is. First, there can be no real socialism without internationalism. Because, of course, national solutions mean relating to your own bourgeoisie, they are necessarily reformist. There can be no real socialism without internationalism. And therefore, there can be no internationalism without a decisive break, politically and organisationally, with the reformists. That, you know, is the core of Lenin's policy. The core of Lenin's policy. And it is the tradition in which we stand. I'm about to say two other things about it. That tradition was marginalised by the ultimate defeat of the Russian Revolution, German Revolution before, 1918 and so on, pushed to the margins of the workers' movement. The effects of Stalinism were devastating. But let us always remember this, comrade. You know, without social democracy, without the betrayals of 1914 and the betrayals of 1918-19, there would have been no Stalinism. There would have been no Stalinism. It was the Social Democrats who destroyed the German Revolution in 1918. Had there actually been, at that time, a reasonably coherent, solid Bolshevik, whatever you want to call it, the revolution had been successful, the state machine had been destroyed, the question was to consolidate and oppose the recreation of the bourgeois state machine. Actually, social democracy, the fundamental enemy. Stalinism had a devastating effect. Fortunately, Stalinism is fading now, and the communist parties have remained, the British one doesn't remain, quickly like a Cheshire cat, you know, fading away, the grin is still there, Monty Johnston, but... it is central to our task, and I don't want to sound chest-beating, because I understand the enormous difficulties. It is central to our task to recreate this tradition, not in the sense of creating something radically new in terms of ideas, the ideas are there, but to recreate this tradition in terms of the living movement. It is an enormously difficult task. There is no question whatsoever about it. But the truth is, internationalism and revolutionary politics go together. You cannot separate the one from the other. You can have holiday internationalism when the sun is shining, yes, I am all for peace with the Argentine, and then when the war comes, the umbrella comes, real internationalism actually is indissolubly connected with a revolutionary attitude to your own bourgeoisie and therefore to the capitalist state, and therefore completely and utterly incompatible with reliance on parliamentary roads to socialism, with or without mass pressure. Yeah. All right, that was Lenin's politics. We have an enormous amount to learn from them, an enormous amount to learn from them, but the most important thing of all, of course, is not simply learning. We have to develop in practice. We have to recreate in practice. I started with the illusions of 1912 and so on. We have to recreate in practice, not the fakery, not the false internationalism, but something of the spirit that informed the movement at that time, so informed the movement that even right-wing fakers like James Keir Hardy and Jean Jaurès felt obliged, Victor Adler felt obliged to pay lip service to. We've a long, long way to go, but at least we know they are moral degenerates. We are actually the only people, I don't say we, the SWP, but I mean the tendency which accepts the Leninist international perspective as a whole, are the only people who have preserved the original socialist vision and are capable of carrying it forward.
Say we are now the fifth international. I would say fourth, actually, but still no. No, it is a nonsense. Why is it a nonsense? Come on, comrades, let's look at the question very seriously. In September 1914, Lenin wrote, "The second international is dead, killed by opportunism. Long live the third international." Meaning we must create, we must recreate the tradition on a better and more authentic basis. Did he then go on to say that he and his handful of supporters, we are the third international? Nonsense. Nonsense. On the contrary, he went through, sought to go through a prolonged process of political intervention and political struggle with the centrists, with the pacifist anti-war people and so on. Why? To gather forces. An international, in any serious sense, the party in any serious sense, actually has to have some people. It actually has to have some significant forces. Otherwise, it is a sectarian fiction, is it not? Come on, is this something that Tony Cliff or someone cooked up? Not at all, not at all. Marx, Lenin was influenced by the example of Marx. The first international was a great step forward. The defeat of the Paris Commune and the pressures on the international afterwards, not to mention the anarchist loonies and so on, produced a situation in which the thing had to be killed, had to be killed. Marx and his associates killed it. They killed it by transferring it to New York. Since the whole basis of the movement was in Europe. Does this mean Marx was not an internationalist? Of course not. Of course not. It is simply that always the key thing for the party, still more for the internationalists, has got to relate to an actual class struggle, to some actual workers on some significant scale. Now, Lenin, the Comintern, the attempt, the call to form the Communist International was not made, well, it was made in February or something like that, Communist International was not founded until April 1919. 5 years, not quite, nearly 5 years after the call. And what years, because it's not just a question of, you know, simple dates. Years of war, catastrophe, revolutions in Germany, revolutions in the Austro-Hungarian Empire, the Turkish Empire, overthrow of regimes, monarchies going right, left and centre, mass radicalisation, mass movements. The International was founded, the New International was founded, on the basis of intervention in those struggles. Okay? Now let us look at our situation. It would be quite easy for us to convene a meeting, I think, and persuade various people who more or less agree with us politically to establish an international organisation with all sorts of pretensions. What's wrong with that? What is wrong with it is that it would mean nothing. Nothing, nothing at all, because we are not in a position to influence the course of events sufficiently, and it would, as a certain unfortunate example shows, tend to lead to delusions of grandeur in our time. We have to face the reality. The conditions for the recreation of an international are the creation in a number of countries of significant revolutionary internationalist tendencies. Now, don't misunderstand me. That doesn't mean to say we take an abstentionist attitude and say, all right, you know, do your own thing and so on. No, we fight for our politics as a tendency, as hopefully an international tendency, but we don't confuse that with the development of an actual international. Still, that is proclamation out of nothing. Come on, it requires great events, great radicalizations to create the conditions in which a real international is possible. They will come, but we can't create them artificially. Now, secondly, Keir Hardie and the general strike. Now, perhaps the comrades thought I was a little unkind to poor old James Keir Hardie. He had a stroke of good luck. You know, he died. Well, I'm sorry, from the point of view of his reputation, I don't mean to be unkind at all, but knowing the man's record, read Donny Gluckstein's article in the current International Socialism, he died before it was necessary for him to support Henderson and Co. himself going to the war cabinet or break decisively with Labour reformism. He was spared that choice by, you know, the avenging angel. But the truth is, that is his whole record. You look at it, here he goes to Stuttgart attacking the Germans, who were opportunists enough in their own way, for not being willing to commit themselves to calling a general strike, knowing very well there was not a hope in hell that the British TUC would do likewise, right? He was doing the left turn on the international scene, as he had often done on the national scene. Let me remind comrades, blindly ridiculous, no, it's not ridiculous. In the struggle against the then Tory Industrial Relations Act in the early 70s, an attempt was made, and it was successful at the end of the day, to commit the TUC, and incredible as it may seem, they became committed to the proposition, one, we don't recognise the law. Two, we don't recognise the court. We defy the decisions of the capitalist courts, right? It was successful. The right wing opposed it. Now, there was a left tie. Who did they put up? A man called Joe Gormley. Then General Secretary of, no, President, I'm sorry, then President of the National Union of Mine Workers. A very, very clever opportunist. You know, he spoke with a broad Wigan accent, broad Lancashire accent. That was part of his act to make people think he's a bit stupid, because Southern was especially, you know. Actually, he was as sharp as a tack. And Joe got up and argued, all this is nonsense. Brothers and sisters, There is only one way in which we can defeat this legislation. A general strike. A general strike or nothing. And Joe Gormley from the extreme right wing was arguing this, 1971 TUC. It sounds very plausible, and there's some idiots on the left, no doubt. I mean, I can think of some groups who would have swallowed it. My dear, if you ask what is its actual content, knowing that that proposition is not to be carried, you pose that against the actual conditions of struggle. Now look, if we look back at that Stuttgart resolution, which I say Lenin helped to draft, and which he was quite proud of, I quoted you what he said about it afterwards, it says, speaking of, you know, the struggle against war to break, by all the means most effective, which naturally vary according to the accentuation of the class struggle and the general political situation. That's true. Now the opportunists can use that to say the time is not right. The time will never be right, for many people. That it can be interpreted that way, but no, it is eminently realistic. The general strike or nothing approach, which was in effect Hardy's, and not just Hardy, to be fair, you know, there are other lefties, some of whom finished up members of war cabinets, who were arguing the same sort of thing at the time. It's that kind of leftism, right, is actually a cover for the right. That's my analysis of the situation there. Now, Lenin, incidentally, voted with the Germans, the French, Russian delegation as a whole, including the ones who later became traitors, against the Hardy proposition. I think they're absolutely right to do so. Now, the question of First and Second World War. Now, this is interesting, but fundamentally simple. We ask ourselves, Lenin wrote a pamphlet in 1915, Socialism and War, which comrades really ought to read, even if they don't read much of Lenin, which is not ranting against simply against the traitors and so on, but starts out with serious analysis. Wars, always barbarous, always brutal. Are we always opposed to them? No, we are not. There are different kinds of wars, and then goes into the whole analysis about progressive, bourgeois, revolutions, the national struggle, all sorts of things, right? Fundamental analysis, coming to the conclusion, the war is an imperialist war. The war is a war for economic and political domination between rival imperialist bourgeoisies. Now I ask, simple question, was that or was that not true of the Second World War? And for me, there's absolutely not the slightest doubt whatsoever about the answer. One word? Yes! Yes! In essence, it was the same. There is, however, a complication. Germany in 1914 was not exactly a bourgeois democracy, but a monarchical semi-autocratic regime in which certain important democratic rights had been established. Germany in 1939-40, were dominated by the fascists. The working class was atomized. That's a difference. That's a very important difference. And it affects the way, tactically, you approach the question. But it does not affect the essence of the matter. You see, Churchill, Roosevelt, and of course I would add Stalin, were in exactly the same position in terms of their aims and aspirations. What did they seek to do? Churchill sought to defend the British Empire, hopefully to expand it, but he was quite a realistic man. He realised it was going down the pan. The point is to keep as much as possible. Roosevelt's objective, strip away the liberal rhetoric, was to establish the United States of America as the imperialist power dominating the greater part of the world. And he was successful, wasn't he? You know, that was the outcome. The essence was the same. Tactically, however, there are problems. So, Comrade specifically says, what do we do? Well, I can tell you what was done. And I claim no credit whatsoever for it, because the position was established before young innocent me was actually drawn into it. The British troops split on the question. Those of them who stayed mouldering away in the Labour Party, you know, the arguments, the mass movement, etc., when the Labour Party was evaporating, you know, membership, mass conscription, political truce, Labour in government, the Labour Party is an organisation with it, I don't mean support with it, they who stuck in there maintained the intransigent revolutionary defeatist position with slogans abstractly correct, quoting Liebknecht, the main enemy is at home, the defeat of one's own government is the lesser evil, and so on and so forth. And you know why they were able to do that? Because actually they talked to people in the Labour Party wards who had practically no one in them. Now the other lot who went out of the Labour Party, and I'll say something about this tomorrow, for anyone who's interested in some, actually we had to sell a paper called Socialist Appeal. And we sold it on the streets and outside workplaces. When I first joined, I was allocated to Dock Gate number 8, Manchester Docks, to sell the Socialist Appeal. And therefore you had to argue the politics, therefore we had a more realistic view. The people who became the majority, the RCP, adopted the real RCP, not the fake imitation, it would be well an imitation, you see, adopted this position, which I believe to have been absolutely correct. We give no political support whatsoever to the British coalition government, Conservative, Labour, Liberal, then later supported by the Communist Party. But we are for the military defeat of Hitler. It was the same position that Trotsky had adopted with respect to the Spanish Republican government. No political confidence, not one iota of political support. Militarily, we are for the defeat of Hitler. What follows? And the slogans on the front of the paper, arm the workers, military training schools under the control of the unions, etc., etc., etc. Militarily, we resist a fascist invasion. Politically, we stand for independent working class politics, no support for class collaboration, no support for Chamberlain, can't admit. Now, many comrades will find that a bit unsatisfactory. I believe it was absolutely correct. Perhaps we can have a discussion about it sometime. You see, but I'll ask you to reflect on this. For Marxists, the notion, independent working class politics, working class struggle, you know? You've always got to seek to put yourself in a position where this fundamental principle can be applied, however difficult the tactical situation is. The line of, you know, parroting Liebknecht, extremely courageous man, he said it in the Reichstag, and he was arrested and sent to a penal battalion at the front for doing it. These people were saying it to one another in the privacy of some room. There's a real difference, isn't there? They could do that. The people to go out and try and influence people in terms of ideas, to attack the government, to attack its British imperialism and so on, actually have to have a point of connection with the people you're talking to. And that means actually, yes, with the military defeat of Hitler, no confidence whatsoever. Churchill is not an anti-fascist, he's a British imperialist. Was there another question? I've got the right sheet, haven't I? Was there another question? Have I missed one? I mean, someone who asked it was there. No one? Oh, right.
Right, we've got time for more comments. I see some indications.
Okay, why not? Yeah. Well, yeah, I'll do it all. Oh, yeah, I won't speak again except right at the end. Maybe that'll be me.
Yeah, Duncan mentioned in passing the experience that we've had more recently with the Argentinian situation over the Malvinas or Falklands. I wondered if the comrades who perhaps weren't involved in that process, whether Duncan could just give a brief explanation as to why we came to the position we did and what its impact was, because for me, in my experience, it was a reinforcement of my understanding my commitment to leave the party, because the effects of the majority of the left position, which was to kind of duck and dive and go on with the war of Syria, that actually really weakened the socialist movement and the movement we had. So Duncan just mentioned a few things about how the party actually came to the position it did and what it involved.
The ANC in South Africa and their politics. I'd just like to ask why the Red International Labour Unions were set up and what were the problems with it?
Why, in fact, did these big parties
German party, the Austrian party, the French party, all this revolutionary rhetoric. And that, you know, was their staple. Why actually, when it came to the crunch, did they do what they did? And they go to Europe. And the fundamental reason is that their rhetoric was revolutionary, their practice had become reformist. You know, in the beginning is the deed, then the theory ultimately is brought into line with it. Because of the particular circumstances in which the socialist parties were excluded from power, right? No question, no one wanted coalitions with them or anything of this sort. In those specific circumstances, it was possible to combine a practical reformist practice with a revolutionary rhetoric. It was possible. After the war came, the governments needed their collaboration. They were forced to choose. And that proved the reality. Those parties that had substantial reformist bases then flipped over. Okay? That's not adequate, I know, but that is the fundamental thing. Now the next thing. The question of small countries. Let's be quite clear about this. Lenin wrote that if it had been a question, you know, the war actually started with the Austrian and Austro-Hungarian declaration of war against Serbia. Had it been a question that you could isolate that war, Lenin was for the defence of Serbia. Under its bourgeois, petty bourgeois government was for the defence of Serbia. But he said, you cannot consider the question in this light. It is part of the whole mass of imperialist conflicts and contradictions. You have to look at the European and world situation. And in these circumstances, we are not for the defence of Serbia, as the Tsarist, right? Tsarist Russia came in to intervene, allegedly to defend Serbia. You have to look at the overall situation, and the only principled position is a position of refusing to support any of the combatants. Actually, the Serbian party, unlike the Belgian ones, I don't want anyone to think I'm anti-Belgian, but the Serbian party actually did take an anti-war position. They had two deputies in the, what is it called, some funny name and I can't pronounce, in their the equivalent of their parliament diet, they stood up heroically and they voted against support for the war. At the end of the meeting they went to prison, of course. Right? They took a correct position. They took it. The Bulgarian party was much bigger. In Bulgaria, because of a whole series of events, circumstances which we can't go into, the revolutionary left dominated the Bulgarian party. The right wing, of course, supported the war, which meant supporting Germany, Austria, Hungary, and so on. The majority took the position, not of support for the Allies, but of no support for either side, revolutionary defeatism, and so on. What does it mean? What does it mean? It doesn't mean that we run around shrieking, saying, revolutionary defeatism, etc., etc. That's bullshit. No, it means that the class struggle is pursued relentlessly, without regard to its military consequences. That we believe, and this is the whole essence of Lenin's argument, and the argument of the revolutionary left in general, there can be no progressive solution to any problem, including the national problem, right, in Europe, except on the basis of workers' power, Soviets, the overthrow of the capitalist class. Now, let us take the Belgian case. The fact is, of course, that the Belgian bourgeoisie did not initiate the war. It's a fact. They certainly did not want to be invaded by the Kaiser's Germany. Not at all. In that sense, they were victims. But come on. Lenin was careful to point out in socialism and war, Belgium is nevertheless an imperialist power. It rules, he said, I don't know what the figures were, 30 million colonial slaves in the Congo, etc., etc., whatever the exact figures. And it is part and parcel of one of the two camps, namely the Russian, French, British camp, which is imperialist to the core. Therefore, no question of military support. Why not? No question of military but no political support. Because in essence, the political structures, political forms in Kaiser's Germany and King Leopold's Belgium were in essence the same. You see, the problem with the Second World War was a different one tactically, I say, because of the actual destruction of the German working class movement. It is simply not true
that the German invasion, you know, the so-called rape of Belgium, and the Allied propagandists made enormous play with this, you know, nuns raped at Louvain and God knows what have you. It is simply not true that actually that resulted in the smashing of the Belgian working class movement. You know what smashed the Belgian working class movement, or what paralysed it? The support of its opportunist leaders for the Belgian government, for Belgian imperialism, and therefore French and British and Russian imperialism. You know, this is a question on which there can simply be no compromise. That in the situation of crisis, to accept the defensive position means to abandon the politics of class struggle in favour of the politics of arguing lesser evil, better this lot of bourgeoisies than the other lot of bourgeoisies, and it has enormous practical consequences. It means not you just having said A, you can't stop there. You have to say B. We are actually in favour of the screwing down of our own working class in the interests of the war. We are in favour of conscription. We are in favour of conscription exists anyway. We are in favour of the denial of trade union rights. We are in favour of repression. And this, comrades, is what they finished up doing. Most important of all, actually, I must set this up on the Belgian case, it so happens that the headquarters of the International Socialist Bureau, were in Brussels. You know, nice neutral country, so they thought. And the dominant figures, therefore, fact of geography, in the International Socialist Bureau, whose duty, remember, was to coordinate the struggle against war. Remember the Stuttgart Resolution, with the aid of the International Socialist Bureau, hasten the downfall of capitalism and so on. You know where they did, actually? They opted off and joined the Belgian government and contributed to the destruction of the International. No, there cannot really be any compromise on that. Now, the question of the centralised International. Let us look at the circumstances. With the benefit of hindsight, not my hindsight, but Lenin's, you see, he had believed in the Second International. It's not true at all that he had seen through it. He had believed. He looked at it. He attempted to analyse it. Opportunism, its material base, the whole development of the tendencies, and he concluded that the new international must be centralised. Why? Not because some ideal organisational scheme, but because essentially it is a question of political struggle to pull the workers who support, first of all the centrists, leftward moving workers, away from their leaders, and of course ultimately the supporters of the right-wing social democrats and so on. For this, a centralised political tendency internationally was necessary. Now, of course it is true that subsequently under Stalin, this thing, progressive I will argue at the time, turned into reactionary instrument. It's a fact of life. But the central thing, wasn't it? That wasn't primarily because it was centralised, but because of what happened to the Russian Revolution, the problem of Stalinism. And we shouldn't either, I'll finish this bit on this, exaggerate the degree of centralisation in the early Comintern. You know, their own position was that the international must take general decisions, but, and I quote, these must take into account the varying conditions in which individual parties have to fight and work, and must take decisions of general validity only when such decisions are possible. That is to say, they wanted to establish a clear, sharp international political line. Not at all the case that Lenin, least of all, thought that actually sitting in Moscow or Petrograd or somewhere, I can work out the details of what the comrades in Iceland ought to do. Not at all. And if you look at the actual practice of the international in its early years, innumerable commissions, innumerable arguments, repeated deviations from the line by various parties, the attempt to deal with this by political argument. I know it is one of the stock arguments of the centrists, that, you know, the 21 conditions, the centralised internationalism, international, this led us to an important contributory factor to Stalinism. They split the movement artificially. This is what someone like Claudin says. I don't know, if people don't know about Claudin, why should I advertise him? He was quite influential.
influentially wrote a book on the Communist International, which certainly much more widely distributed than mine ever likely to be, short of the revolution. You know, he says, in effect, they artificially split the movement. You know what the answer to that is? And imposed this centralised dogmatic thing. The split in the movement occurred in August 1914. That was the real split, the gigantic split, the disruption, the total disruption of the international by the right. The centralised international of 1919 was an attempt, necessarily centralised, to pull together the revolutionary elements in order for a hard, sharp fight against the centrists and then against the reformists. I am not going to argue that every one of the 21 conditions was right. I think at least two of them were misguided. That's with the great advantage of hindsight, of course. Okay? Nevertheless, there's no question whatsoever in my mind that the opponents of what they call Bolshevik centralization opposed it because they wanted to maneuver opportunistically in their own countries. They wanted to come to an accommodation with the right-wing socialist parties and so on. That's classically true in of the French and of the Norwegians. The whole argument, it was called autonomy. And I'm always suspicious when someone talks about autonomous movements. I say, autonomous of whom? Autonomous of whom? Actually, the demand for autonomy was, in fact, leave us alone in France, in Norway, etc. Don't criticise our opportunity. You don't understand France, Norway, and so on. We all go our own way. It was a return, an attempt to return to the conditions of the Second International. And as such, I think wrong. I'm not going to argue either that the Comintern, even in Lenin's day, did not make some stupid decisions. It did. That's a fact. Any living movement makes mistakes. And of course, if you centralise, you amplify the mistake, don't you? And if we make a mistake and no one pays any heed to us, thank God, the consequences are not very great. Centralisation carries its own costs, its own penalties. Nevertheless, it was indispensable. It was, above all, not an organisational, but a political question. What was the key thing about that centralisation? It was to drive out of the international, people were coming into it, you know, leftward-moving workers, people who wanted to manoeuvre, speak left. Karl Kautsky. James Ramsay MacDonald, one of them. He was specifically, you know, said we must have him out. By name, future Labour and then Conservative Prime Minister of Britain. It was, you know, a specific political operation. Okay. Lenin, by the way, towards the end of his life, last speech he ever made, maybe a long thing, which I will not inflict upon you, saying, you know, we adopted all these organisational rules, they are too Russian, they are a blockage, we'll not go forward along these lines. All right. Does that mean he was wrong in 1921? I don't think so. It means that you make a turn, you pursue a course, it has certain advantages, then you see the disadvantages are beginning to outweigh the advantages. Lenin, above all, was flexible on organisational questions. Now, I don't want to talk about the ANC, not because I want to dodge the question, but come on, comrades, it's been raised in meeting after meeting after meeting. I'm going to leave it aside. Just to talk about two other things. The Red International of Labour Unions. When it was conceived, when it was conceived, it seemed a good idea, because the other side was in disarray. By the time it was executed, it was quite clearly, in my view, with the great benefit of hindsight, a mistake. But I will say this, that in that case, the hindsight ought to have been, you know, there's enough experience for Lenin, Trotsky, Zinoviev and the rest to see that it was a mistake. Actually, they persisted with it and then tried to, if you like, disembarrass themselves through a series of operations. It was a mistake, comrades. All right. No movement is perfect. The question finally of the... No. Next to finally, the Argentine War. But it was no problem for us. There was never any problem. We stand in the internationalist tradition. How could we possibly support the British government in a war with the Balkans? I mean, the question never arose. The only question that did arise was the argument of some people who are worthy, they were against the war, excellent, excellent, that's 9/10 of the way to virtue, but they couldn't quite make the 1/10 because they looked at the old text, you know, and the Argentine was a semi-colony of Britain in 1916 when Lenin wrote imperialism, and therefore they said, actually, you must say, victory to the Argentine! Because, Argentine's a semi-colonial country and so on. It was factually rubbish. The world had changed, right? We said, against the war, Down with the war. Absolutely correct. We didn't say Victor de Galtieri. We were quite right in not saying Victor de Galtieri. Okay. I conclude with this thought. You know, the circumstances in which the internationalists, a very small minority of internationalists, in the early years of the First World War, I speak about the First World War, which this is when it happened, this is one of the great fundamental break in the working class movement, the circumstances in which they operated were incomparably more difficult than those under which any opposition, most countries anyway, operate today. It is a fact that Dotzenberg, Geyser, went to prison. The only reason many of them didn't go to prison was he was exiled in Switzerland. Many of us went to prison. John McClane. Many were shot. James Baldwin. Lee Neck himself in Luxembourg went to prison. Therefore, under exceedingly difficult circumstances, not always seeing the way forward, but formed as a matter of principle, and they did succeed in creating an internationalist tradition which was both genuine and substantial for a period of years. Now, all our discussion, criticisms, were they right about this, were they wrong about this, fine, are relevant only insofar as we dedicate ourselves under easier conditions, much easier conditions, to the reconstruction of the international movement in the spirit of Lenin, in the spirit of Marx, in the spirit of Lenin, in the spirit of Trotsky and so on. And that means actually doing something about it. It means participating in an organisation, comrades. No question, no two ways about it. It is very interesting to discuss the experiences. Why do we discuss them? We are not a society of professional historians. We are people following in the spirit of Marxist aphorism who seek to change the world. And to change the world, you must build first a revolutionary party in various countries and then a revolutionary international. But you must take part in doing that. You must build, you must participate.